Blackstone Publishing presents BLM, The Making of a New Marxist Revolution by Mike Gonzalez. This book is read by John McLain. To my sister, Lucy. Introduction. On January 6, 2021, the holy day of the Epiphany, a few hundred supporters of Donald Trump occupied the Capitol building while Congress met to certify the votes of the 2020 election. The representatives of the people had to be whisked to safety while the protesters marauded through some of the most sacrosanct halls of our nation's democracy. Trump, then in his last days as president, was instantly accused and convicted of inciting the crowd by the press, the Democrats, and even some members of his adopted Republican Party. Trump had indeed spoken to the rioters minutes earlier in front of the White House, some 3.6 miles from Capitol Hill. "I know that everyone here will soon be marching over to the Capitol building to peacefully and patriotically make your voices heard," he told them. He also said, "If you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore." For that, the House of Representatives impeached the president 2 weeks later, the first time in U.S. history that a president has been twice impeached. Trump was later acquitted by the Senate. The January 6th attack certainly was disturbing. An unruly mob of buffoons had invaded the People's House and threatened America's elected representatives, sending a signal to the nation and the world that something wasn't quite right with the country. This was, moreover, a political attack. The attackers did something else that was shameful. They gave some political leaders an excuse not to be frank about the Black Lives Matter organizations and their leaders, a group of Marxists who do not just want to defund the police, empty the prison system, and eliminate the courts, as bad as that in itself would be. I myself saw this at a May 26, 2021 hearing of the House Subcommittee on Civil Rights and Civil Liberties, in which I testified about Black Lives Matter. My mere mention of the damage BLM had wrought made two members of the squad, Representative Ayanna Pressley, Massachusetts, and Representative Rashida Tlaib, Michigan, livid. BLM's leaders seek to dismantle the organizing principle of this society, words spoken by the main founder of BLM, as I will explain in this book. Unfortunately, the Capitol attackers validated a long-standing, stubborn liberal axiom that right-wing militancy was a much greater threat than the left-wing version. This reflexive but false belief had been used again and again over the previous 7 years to prevent any reasonable discussion of where the BLM organizations wanted to take America. The January 6th attack handed the liberal establishment something to hang on to and use to deflect attention from the real existential danger posed by BLM. As it was, politicians had already found it impossible to criticize Black Lives Matter because the concept that Black Lives Matter is so unimpeachable. Who could be against Black Lives Mattering? Rancid racists do exist and always will. But Americans, by and large, are not racist, and they do want justice and equality among the races. This is indeed the reason that the BLM organizations, which are committed to radically changing the way of life of the freest, most prosperous society on earth, use the BLM label. Other labels, such as Red Ideas Matter or Dismantling the Family Matters, wouldn't have worked, though they would more truly represent organizations that advocate policies that make it more difficult for all individuals to succeed, and thus close racial gaps. Making this conversation harder to have is ironically the most important impact the Capitol attackers are likely to have on society. Other than that, the groups said to have been involved have very little power over our lives. For all the awful symbolism of the attack, those groups, the Proud Boys, the Boogaloo Boys, the Three Percenters, QAnon, do not have a political action committee, bills in Congress, millions of dollars in hand, a curriculum being disseminated to the country's 14,000 school districts, a sycophantic media that acts as a press agent, or the cultural cachet that lets BLM partner with the musical Hamilton. Nor do they have economic and foreign policy views, or an academic discipline that underpins their ideas. As this book will inform you, BLM has all these things. It is already changing your life. The January 6th attack, for all the media apoplexy that accompanied it, is already being forgotten, which is why pundits keep bringing it up again and again and calling it an insurrection. BLM had already changed society when the Capitol was occupied. America on January 5, 2021, was unrecognizable from a year earlier, in everything from sports to office work to school curricula to legislation. And what happened a day later gave us an emboldened left that felt it had the moral upper hand and a reason to stop, cancel, or jail anyone daring to stand athwart BLM and yell, "Stop!" The left and its supporters in the press immediately seized the moment to cry that an insurrection or even a coup had been attempted. For months after January 6th, a media that had been openly supportive of the 2020 mayhem minutely analyzed what they ludicrously built up to be the equivalent of 9/11 and Pearl Harbor. Unreported went the fact that January 6th was not the first time the Capitol had been attacked, and that the three previous acts of aggression, including terrorists shooting at congressmen point-blank from the House Visitors Gallery, were all perpetrated by leftists who were later released from prison by Democratic presidents. When Representative Maxine Waters urged BLM protesters to become even more bellicose in the streets prior to the announcement of the verdict on Derek Chauvin, the police officer who eventually, April 20, 2021, was found guilty of killing George Floyd, the media and all the other institutions controlled by the left simply looked the other way. Waters, a radical who represents a district that covers South Los Angeles, told the protesters, "We got to stay on the street. We've got to get more active. We've got to get more confrontational. We've got to make sure that they know that we mean business." The parallels with what Trump said could not have been more blunt, except that Waters did not tell her audience to remain peaceful. The judge overseeing Chauvin's trial, Peter Cahill, called Waters' comments abhorrent and disrespectful to the rule of law and the judicial branch, and he warned that they could be used to overturn the verdict. But how did the left, so outraged 3 months earlier, react? Crickets. Waters was not impeached. Which insurrection? The United States was confronted with an insurrection, but was it on January 6th?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.